nice in this chair, so I can lean a little bit and be more flexible while talking. Well, as you notice, between intellectual and sensory reason, architecture and the overcoming of presence. I would like to elaborate a little bit on this topic. what is important, I think, now I don't want to anticipate anything. I think I don't want to set up a certain mindset or philosophical basis on which we are supposed or should base our discussions in this week. I think this is not the intention. I don't want to insinuate anything what we have to do here, but I think this is going to come out, will be the result of somehow the dynamics which will be developed. Of course, we have a lot of expectations, surely, and we have a lot of curiosity, but I think this is the basic for us here to work in the next 4 or 5 days. What I would like to present you here is maybe 4 pillars or 4 aspects or maybe directions or bases. Four topics will come up, and I will give a short introduction into these topics. It's fragmentary, of course. I would like to keep it simple and somehow so that it's that everybody can follow. I think it's very important. So that if we, in the terms of philosophy, I often make the experience in my class about philosophy and architecture. Students, they think they have to talk in an incredibly complicated fashion, and if they write you nothing, you cannot understand anymore what I mean. But I think this is philosophy. The topic, the approach, the topic of architecture philosophy, and a kind of preliminary classification of architecture philosophy. And then I want to go into a case study. It's doors. Not only about doors, but it's very close to architecture, where I would like to point out some specificity of architecture which distinguishes architecture from other fields of cultural practice, mainly philosophy. And this I will introduce through doors and other things. Okay, so let me start here. what I would also like to point out this is, of course, if you talk about architecture philosophy as a kind of academic field which is just about research to come up, is not that simple. I think it was always, architecture was always somehow a part of philosophy talk. It was used in terms of metaphors. There was never any problem to talk about architecture from a philosophical standpoint. As philosophers talk about everything, because it's the world in its entirety, which is the field of philosophy. But what I'm a little bit more interested in is not this, but more how architecture can become a medium of philosophy. And I think this is quite distinguished from just a general talk about architecture. From the point of view of philosophy. So how architecture can turn itself into a meaning? What is it that enables or makes or has the possibility for architecture to be a meaning for creation of knowledge, basically? And so it's not about architecture as an object for philosophical talk, but architecture is a subject of philosophy. So let me first turn to intellectualization of perception. So between intellectual and sensory reason towards an epistemology of architecture. This, of course, addresses the 2 central features of architecture. It is the togetherness of the sensual, which is so characteristic for architecture. So architecture is a material practice. Of course, it's about appeals to the senses. In a sense, at the same time, very basic, you need some knowledge and some idea how to build and how to construct. So architecture, of course, is always a practice which combines both extremes, if you want so, and that's probably one of the specificities of architecture. It's more extreme than painting. Of course, also painting is a kind of a material-based cultural practice. But in terms of architecture, there are a lot of other things coming in. So the needs, anthropological needs, I will talk about this later. It's about this building up spaces where people can live and where people can have a good life. So architecture is kind of necessity for us more than paintings probably. So actually the sensual and the intellectual are not only together, but I think they are in a very complex way intertwined in architecture. They are mutually stimulating and fertilizing themselves. And they are often as interwoven so that you cannot distinguish the one from the other. And this is probably one of the tasks we have to address here, to analytically, scientifically describe the way they interact. So to separate the two fields and also combine them in the end. So many philosophers presented many interesting theories on how these functions, uncountable or also uncountable, undertaken to the better understanding of how architecture works. But I think there's no really convincing theory or let's say set of mindset which really explains this. So back in the middle of the 18th century, we could maybe retrace somehow the beginning of this of this field of addressing the sensory and the intellectually in the intellectual. Of course, it's the Enlightenment. It starts definitively with Gottlieb Alexander Baumgarten in 1750, he brought out a book which is called Aesthetica, was written still in Latin, but he addresses somehow the sensual, the senses, as something that had to be taken serious. While philosophy, up to then, was less interested in the senses than somehow in the intellectual discourse. So, not only work the senses in a rational manner, as he held, but beyond this, they are also a means of producing knowledge. So, through the senses, of course, the senses also produce knowledge. This is why Alexander Gottlieb Baumann talks about the analogon rationis. So, he says the senses are analog or equivalent to rational thinking. But in a very specific way. And since then, I think we have myriads of theories which address somehow the reason in the senses. It's perception theory, of course, it's experimental psychology, it's the physiology of the senses, various branches of phenomenology, gestalt theory, visual studies, and so on. They all address this this field. And maybe not to forget the image sciences you talked about. Today's you will address this topic. But we see not only, I think, we do not see only a growing number of sciences dealing with the reason of the senses, but we witness also a change of the senses themselves. I think this is also part of what we have to address. Compared to the 19th century, or even the early 20th or the 20th century, today people see, hear, and smell differently. Our senses grew more sensitive, as well as more intellectual, I would like to call it. So, I would like to quote here Adolf Loos, in his introduction to his seminal text, Ornament and Crime, he exactly addresses this as something that is a core issue of modernity. So, here it is. So when man is born, his sensory impressions are like those of a newborn puppy. His childhood takes him through all the metamorphosis of human history. At two, he sees with the eyes of a Parthian. At four, with those of an ancient Teuton. At six, with those of Socrates. At eight, with those of Voltaire. When he is eight, he becomes aware of violet, the color discovered by the 18th century, because before that, the violet was blue and the purple smelled red. The physicist points today to colors in the solar spectrum, which already have a name, but the knowledge of which is reserved for the men of the future. The first part, I think, I don't want to address somehow his philo or ontogenetic explanation of somehow the development of men. Also, the concept of evolution of culture, which is inherent in this concept, I think it's not interesting. But I think the last part is interesting. Yes, it's now the physicists already have an idea of certain colors. They can name them, they see them on their screens, but we are not yet able to distinguish these colors. As he said, as a kind of historical example, he says, well, there was a time when the violet was blue and the purple smelled red. So, where people were not yet able to distinguish this color. And so he gives an example of what I would call is about somehow the intellectualization of perception. And I would hold that today with with the new digital medias, I think we are bound also to change our senses, to make them sensitive to other things, maybe lose other sensitivity for certain effects, but I think there is a change, and I would even hold that the younger generation today sees differently than the older one, the pre-digital generation, just like me. So the intellectualization of perception, I think you can also, it's throughout the art history, you can show somehow there is a kind of intellectualization. And also in architecture theory or in architecture in general, I think the modernity, what we call abstract art or minimalist architecture, I think this is only placeholders for not being exactly able to know what happened. But there is something, I will show you some examples later, which address somehow this, or which I go to highlight what I would like to term the process of the intellectualization of perception. So, thus, in regard to architecture, the questions are: how can these changing relations between the intellectual and the sensual be conceptualized? What does it mean, the reason of the senses? And how and where does it manifest itself in architecture? And where does it manifest itself in philosophy, of course? What is the methodology to find out the secrets of the senses? What does it mean for the relation of architecture and philosophy in general? So let me now turn to my second point, the classification of architecture theory. I think in addressing the topic of architecture philosophy, the summer school, as I've already pointed out in the introduction, addresses is about to venture into new territories, if you want. So architecture philosophy has, as such, is a scholarly field which is rather about to be established. And so bringing the two sides of the divide together, philosophy and architecture. Architecture as a cultural practice is based on materiality, strongly based on its materiality, while philosophy is based on words, on language. So why this emerging interest in architectural philosophy? Well, I think on the one side, it has to do with the changing cultural status of architecture. On the other side, it has to do with the changes in development within architecture. I think this is important to distinguish this. One reason may be the growing intellectualization of perception, but moreover it seems to be triggered by the processes of, I mentioned it already, digitalization in the way of how they undermine the traditional notion and practices of architecture. And I think this was something very important to be distinguished. While the first machine age, the analog machine, and analog production methods inflicted architecture from the outside. All the modern digitalization changed architecture from within. And I think this is a very important thing to be noted. So for within means it changes its very essence. It changes the century-old knowledge base of architecture, so computer in general, but computational design, algorithmic design, building information modeling, new ways of production, CNC milling, and so on, the technique of 3D printing. I think all these techniques interfere with the knowledge structure, the traditional knowledge structure of architecture. And I think this somehow leads to a rethinking of architecture as a cultural practice, very much on this basis. So I want to hold that the growing interest in architecture philosophy has to do with the growing self-awareness of architecture which comes with these kind of changes, so in regard to its theoretical basis. As a matter of fact, over the last 50 years, we witnessed an ever-growing interest in architecture theory, mostly forced upon architecture by its changing cultural status. And it is the better theoretical understanding of architecture that this necessitates a more subtle distinction of the way architecture is questions or questions itself. So let me briefly explain this. So I see architecture theory as developing in four stages. We have a very long stage of reflection on architecture. Then it is followed by thinking, which I would call traditional theory, then critical theory, then the critical epistemology of architecture. Where does this come from, this classification? I think reflection on architecture, this is the way architecture was treated or how architecture reflected on architecture in feudal societies. So up to maybe the mid of the 19th century, maybe in England it was a little bit earlier, already the beginning of the 19th century, but it has to do with the changes inflicted by the steam engine, by industrialization, by introducing machine production, and so on, by modernity, if you want. So up to then, I think architecture did not change very much. It did not change. It changed maybe stylistically. So we have the Gothic style and the Renaissance, Baroque, Mannerism, Rococo, and so on, and Classicism. But at the core of architecture was rather stable. It was, of course, the way it represented itself or how it represented society. This changed through style, but architecture, its basic and core values, I think, did not change. And this change, mentioned here 1485, for not going too much back in history, but this is the year when Alberti's book finally came out. His 10 books on architecture finally came out printed in print in 1485, although it was already finished, I think, in 62. Until 1850, approximately, of course, these dates have to be treated with caution. 1850 or 51, this is when the Crystal Palace was erected in Hyde Park in London, the first modern building. Of course, add a couple of decades to one or the other side, it doesn't matter, but we have to pin it down somehow, and I think there is a reason to pin it down at 1850. And then traditional theory, then a change started in architecture. Now I would hold that between 1850 and, let's say, the after-war period, architecture deals, of course, with the new conditions of society, with mass society, with the new political systems, the switch from, in certain countries, from a feudal system, from monarchy to to the Republic, machine production, steam engine, electrification, and these kind of things. It is strange as architecture, because architecture then, it has to react to these things. New issues came up, new building types had to be developed, architecture was more, well, it changed its cultural status. It was not anymore about only about representation, but it was somehow integrated in a kind of integrated into the changes in society. But architects were, of course, like the protagonists of modern architecture, be it Mies, Gropius, Terragni, Cattaneo, whoever it is. I think they dealt with these issues, but they dealt with these issues in a very specific way. They were trying somehow to bring back architecture to its basics, to its very nature, somehow. It was not about novelty in the first place. I think we have a kind of difficult understanding and very problematic understanding of avant-garde. Avant-garde was always bringing things back to its essentials. And how to, the question was how to connect this new phenomena to bring it in line with history, with somehow with the knowledge of architecture. And this can be clearly shown that there's a latent classicism in modern architecture, in where they all tried somehow to reconnect somehow to certain ideal which they considered to be basic. You can find it in the architecture of Le Corbusier, very strongly, there's a formal classicism. You can also, it's also obvious in the work of Mies van der Rohe, which is not a formal classicism, but it's a conceptual classicism, which goes all the way back to the discussions of Schinkel, so to the idealistic romanticism, and so on. And then there's this break in the 1950s where architecture becomes self-reflexive, modern architecture. Modern architecture became problematic. It showed its deficits, and so there was a reflection on architecture, but not anymore a reflection on history. And this double reflection, double reflexivity of architecture, then constitutes somehow a new mode of dealing with architecture in its societal or social context. I would call it a critical theory. Actually, it's also called critical theory of what certain architects or theorists did. And as you might have noticed, the distinction between reflection on architecture, traditional theory, and critical theory, of course, the basic is critical theory, it's Horkheimer and Adorno, because they exactly make this kind of distinction, and I think it is, it's very valid also in the context of architecture. So critical theory is self-reflexivity of architecture, which somehow is a third phase, and I would introduce a fourth phase, which is a critical epistemology of architecture. This, of course, is, if I say 2000, it's also very approximate. We are right at the beginning, I think, of this phase, and maybe later scholars, maybe in the middle of the century, might not do this distinction anymore. As we are probably in this process, I think it makes sense for the time being to do this, to make this distinction, to distinguish critical theory from critical epistemology of architecture. This is what I mentioned before, that now the digital technologies somehow interfere with the knowledge structure of architecture, while modern architecture still somehow was influenced from the outside, kept and tried to keep its essence somehow, or its fundamental principles. And here I think that there's, now it's about more the knowledge structure of architecture, the way it produces knowledge, the way it is influenced by the other knowledge systems. So these are the four categories which I would distinguish architecture theory. And then, you see this dotted line? I think this is very important for me, because now architecture is somehow forced. Architecture theory is not anymore theory in the classical sense, but then it has to address the philosophical issues or enter into a philosophical discourse. And not by chance, years from the 1950s onwards, somehow architecture theories somehow they refer to philosophical systems in order to explain the various aspects of architecture, which is, it starts of course with linguistics, with structuralism, post-structuralism, and with transformational grammar, for example, with semiotics, with information theory, and so on. So these philosophical systems become a kind of tool in order to better understand architecture as it presented itself in this period. So from there on, there's this link. There is a link between philosophy and theory of architecture, although the philosophies, they are still somehow, you know, they are kind of, how can I say it? They help somehow to understand. They stay somehow still outside of the architectural discourse, although they are the basis for it. It's the theorizing. So I would say, so it's somehow there's a new connection between philosophy and theory and architecture beginning in the after-war period, starting with the kind of critical double reflexivity of the architectural discourse. Now I come to my third point. It's a classification of architecture philosophy, and therefore I would suggest these three basic discourses that somehow through which we can address architecture in its philosophical context. This is first anthropology, aesthetics, and epistemology. In everything else results from this. If you talk about ethics, it results from this. If you talk about philosophy of technology, semiotics, and so on, it all results out of this. So anthropology, it's in regard, of course, architecture in regard to human existence. Normally we talk about function, often architecture. It's a function of this. This is the bedroom, this is the living room, and this is a lecture room, and this is a staircase, this architecture is functional. I would like to replace this and more talk about human needs. It's because the term function is it's poisoned in the discourse, because it's ideologically it became an ideological term for many many ideologies. I would then rather talk about needs. It's the anthropological needs which one of the bases for architecture. Then aesthetics, I think it is in regard to our sensory experience in terms of the senses, how we are connected to and how we receive our surrounding environment. So it has also to do with communicative function. and then epistemology, it has to do with the knowledge practice of architecture, not only in regard to technology, but also in regard to society, to sociology, and so on. So it's also a vast field. And if you look close, I thought maybe I saw a kind of parallel to Kant's three categories of the practical reason, aesthetic judgment, and pure reason. I'm not so sure about this, but what I was always intrigued when I reread Kant's critique judgment, that aesthetics is placed in between pure reason and practical reason. So he places aesthetics in between. Aesthetics is that link which is able to link those two things. And I found this very intriguing, and but I do not exactly know yet how it works, but well, maybe there's intuition that there is something interesting to it, that maybe Kant is a very theoretical person who probably did not experience too much architecture in his time in Paris, but that he also had an intuition about these kind of things. Alright, so this the three the classification of architecture philosophy as I would like to propose and yeah, as a basis. Now let me come to the fourth to the fourth topic. It's overcoming presence and how architecture opens itself to philosophical content. How it itself becomes the means of philosophy. This is still very tentatively thought, but I would like to make this major distinction or highlight it of architecture, how architecture is distinguished on one level from philosophical talk. Philosophy is based on language, definitively. Architecture is based on material, definitively. And here it becomes very interesting. For example, if you look at how architecture presents itself, it has to do with the signs and semiotics and the sign quality of architecture. The most important distinction is that words, in linguistics they always refer to other things. A word is nothing, almost nothing. It's a little bit of paint, it's a kind of form. Yes, it has some material basis. You have, of course, a sheet of paper. You have the graphite of your pencil or ink. But if you read, when we read books, we do not notice really, you know, we do not reflect on the materiality of what is. If it comes to art and graphic design, of course, it's a different thing. Yeah, somehow there's a change, but normally we do not notice it and we do not want to notice it. So we want to read somehow, we want to get somehow where the words refer to or what they do in our mind. So the word itself is nothing, it refers to something other which is often not present, which is absent. Okay, talk here about trees. There's no tree, they're absent, there's somewhere out there, or we are talking about the Mediterranean Sea. It's out there, but it's not here. And it's the fantastic thing about words that it enables us to talk, to communicate about things which are not present. Architecture is the other way around. Architecture, there's the sign carrier, as we call it in semiotics. It's the most important thing in the first place. In the first place, it doesn't talk about other things, but it talks about itself. Take this door. Now we are with the doors. Take this door. This door is, we all are able to perceive it. It tells us that it is a door, that there is a door. You have the handle, you have the hinges, you have the door frame, you have a kind of opening, the shadow indicates us that it's not a wall, but there is something, you know, a kind of opening. And it suggests also, this is about affordance, about that we can move the handle, that we can, that there's a keyhole, that we can lock it, and so on, and we can open it. So, architecture means, architectural sign, it first indicates itself. This door talks in the first place about itself and not about other doors, historically or whatever. It talks about itself. this is the major distinction between words and architecture as a material practice. Architecture has to indicate itself. Take, for example, the door on the right hand side. If you close these things, you only see books, but the door is. The door disappeared. This is a door, a secret door, somewhere in a castle, somewhere in a cloister, I think it's in Switzerland. if it's gone, it doesn't indicate itself, it's a secret door. It's for us, it's not the door. Only if you know it, that there is something behind, you know it's a door. So a door has to indicate itself, its function. as the left-hand drawer does, clearly does. This is a modern function, this drawer. It does nothing else than say, adding a door. Handles, hinges, door frame, and these kind of things. This tells I am a door. While on the right-hand side, the door, if it's closed, doesn't tell it. It's a secret door, it doesn't exist. For the person, for the viewer, for the user, it doesn't exist. It does exist only for those people who know that it has something behind. In the middle, we have an example that the door does two things. It tells about itself. Unfortunately, it's in the dark, but of course there are door handles and everything what you need in order that the door indicates itself. That it says, here I am a door, you can use it, me. But then it does a little bit more. It refers also to other things, through style, through form, through metaphors, through images. So it tells about something about St. Luke's, maybe, so this is in Venice, or St. Mark's. It talks about a certain tradition in which Venice, or the door, or the square hand is. So it refers also to things which are not present. It refers to history, it refers to things which are maybe a mile away. So this one has both. And so, I think I just wanted to make this distinction that it's very important that that architecture in the first place, is the sign in architecture totally different. It's just upside down from the sign in language. This is why it's difficult if we take, you know, to talk about architecture as the language of architecture. It's itself a metaphor. It's a language, yes. No, it's a system of communication, but it's not language-like. This was always, this was the problem in the 1950s, 60s, with the structuralist modes, with the reference to Saussure's linguistics in architecture. It never worked out, because linguistics, Saussure, is based on words, on linguistics, and not on material practice like architecture. So how comes then somehow the visual, the perceptive, the sensory? I would like to elaborate a little bit on this, on the sign character of architecture. It is very interesting that Piranesi on the right hand side, Sebo, but Fritz Sebo on the left hand side. They both reacted to Vitruv. Vitruvius said, well, that the Greek temple in stone is something which is a translation from the wooden structure in the stone construction. And therefore all the ornaments, all the signs explain themselves. He said these ornaments are not inventions. But there are kinds of means of communication, the logic of the building. It is rather clear. If you look, it's now in Italian, but gave this lecture once in Milano, but it's so the triglyph and the metrope, so they somehow react to the structure of the rafters, the ceiling or roof construction. You see there's the rafters and there's a space in between. And with the stone construction, of course, the roof and the ceiling, they are still made in wood. But it was wanted that the temple should look, should be a solid, look very solid, made out of stone totally. So, but architecture is an invention, is a human invention, which is not referring, which is not mimetically copying anything in nature, which is a really a kind of human invention. Aristotle talks about this, or refers to this. So architecture has to explain itself to people, you know, how it is made, how it functions. Affordance, we talked already about affordance. Affordance of architecture has to indicate itself, what it is for. And also in this case, it has to explain itself.
So what they introduce is this kind of signs, the metrope and the triglyph. The triglyph is an indicator of the rafter behind, and the metrope, which is the open space between, is the indicator of the space between the rafters. So it's so simple. The triglyph, maybe the three pieces here, maybe they come as a style. It's a stylish way to somehow, you know, when you treat the wood with the rust. So you make this kind of structure that might be a stylized, might come from this. And so all the ornaments originally come, they are not inventions, but there is a logic, a reason to it. We can say the first signs in architecture are indexes, indexical signs. They indicate something which is behind it. They are not icons, they are not symbols, but they have the only function to indicate the indexes of what is behind. So there's a close relation between the sign, the triglyph, and what is behind, what it refers to, the rafter. Although the rafter you don't see, it is present, but there's an indexical notion between, or connection between the sign and what it refers to. And first of all, it refers to architecture, and not outside architecture, but to a kind of internal, technical, internal, material condition of architecture. The same thing, okay, here again, we have also the mutu, the dentals, and so on. Whatever you find above on the architrave, on the, what is it called in English? On the, anyway, architrave, whatever there is, you know, it has a reason. It is, you know, there's a reason to it. It's all indicators, stylized, yes. At the end, it's not anymore exactly the triglyph indicates, doesn't indicate exactly the rafter, but it indicates a kind of structure behind, maybe behind somehow the space between is a little bit different, but it doesn't matter. It indicates a kind of, in this case, a system, construction system. Also, the mutilated, the dentals, and whatever that is. The same thing happens, the same logic, also the Greek column works. So the Greek columns are not inventions, they are ornamentation. So the basis, the capital, the emphasis, it's not an invention. There was not someone who said, well, I have the idea that it could be nice to do something like a basis, which is a little bit like it is. Or that someone invented the covering from capital or the Doric capital. No, it's all out of the logic of construction, the logic of material, and also the logic of anthropological needs, which come together in this piece of architecture. So, for example, the entasis, you know? I think the entasis is not an image, but it's an index. It indicates, it is supposed to indicate the flow of forces which come from above. And the forces, they are resisting forces of the material and they are in balance. In order to show that the concept behind architecture, it's theoretical concept in terms of construction, so in order to indicate it, to explain it to the people, what happens, why you are able to build a building, why it is able to stand up, the emphasis is introduced. So it shows that there is a balance, you know, it's as if the stone was a little bit squeezed, but there's a balance, you cannot squeeze more, and there's a force and a counter force, and it is in balance, it is safe. Same thing with the bases, there are different bases, there also are different capitals, but they all have these topics somehow to translate a concept, abstract concept, intuitive concept, how it works with the forces in the building into an image. These images are not icons, they are indexes, they are indicators of the concept behind. We don't know exactly how the forces flow. It's also an abstract idea. It works. We are able to build buildings, very high buildings, but it's still an abstract idea, which it's a matrix, it's a model, and it works as a model. And this is translated into an image, and this image is not anymore, but it's not an icon, it's not a symbol, it's an index. So it all starts indexically. In a modern building, like on the right-hand side, you also have these indexes. If you have a concrete, open concrete wall, you see exactly, you know, how code is made, you see where the nails were, and so on. Even with this construction, these arches, you know, it explains how the building was made. The arch is not a figure, an indexical figure, which tells us something about the construction idea of building in bricks. And in the building reference, you know, there's an image how you build in concrete. It's index. It's index, it's not symbolic yet. The interesting thing is now, you see in the backs, you see the rafters, you know, they are parallel to the front, to the tympanum. They run parallel to the tympanum. So it is justified to have the metope and dry leaf ornamentation on this, on the long side of the temple, but not on the short side, because the rafter runs parallel to it. No, there are no rafters hitting somehow the front. Nevertheless, they somehow they carry through somehow around the concept of or the figure of a triglyph in metrical. Although on the front side here, it is not anymore literally indicating rafters or construction, what is hidden, and what I would call a degenerate index. It has somehow, it's still on somehow on the same level as the rafters, but they indicate only in a loose way rafters, because the head of the rafter is not anymore. The rafters run parallel to the front facade. And here an interesting thing happens. So the indexical function is weakened. Already in the Greek temple, with a weakened indexicality of certain elements. So the triglyph in the metrope in the front facade is a different, has a different status than the triglyph and the metrope on the long facade. They are different in their relation to what they refer to in terms of their indexicality. And you can see this here, well, again, so we have, we can trace a kind of line of degeneration of the index. Originally we have indexes, then we have degenerated indexes. And these indexes, degeneration, can go to a point where the element loses its indexicality totally, and then it is open to be somehow connotated with other meaning. Then we talk about symbols or icons. And then it's not anymore about the building. So this element doesn't talk anymore about the building, its rational, but it talks about another rational, which it refers to the outside, to something absent. What they did here, they told the story of the making of mankind. So it's about mythology. You have the Centaurs and the Lepidus and so on. There's a story told from Greek mythology. It tells another story of the make of making. It's now the making of man. While before with the index, it was the story of the making of the building. So we have this in history. We have this line. The degeneration from index to symbol. But we also have the development in the other direction. So there are times in architecture where architects are tired of these symbols, which have nothing to do anymore with architecture, just like here. This is not anymore degenerated index, it's not anymore an index, it's a kind of kitsch, we would say. Also this little house in, which I found in by chance in Tokyo, you know, which mimics kind of classical building in a horrible way. So it doesn't tell anything about the construction behind. but anyway, so this is a totally degenerate index. And so we have this, you know, on the one hand we have the development from index to symbol, to a process of degeneration. And we have once in a while in architecture, it happens that the architects that want to bring back, to renew the sign or architecture in its symbolic or sign quality, to renew it and bring it back to its basic element in order to start again to establish a new language of architecture. So it's the recoding the symbol into an index. I don't know whether this is called, but a reverse degeneration process. And this always happens in, you know, when we talk about an epoch, when an epoch newly starts, from high Gothic to Renaissance. In this case, it's a Brunelleschi. So high Gothic was a highly mannerist style. So it was about image, as you can see here. This is the most famous example. It has, you know, it is very much detached from its original architectural, technological, and material basis. It's very much detached, very much degenerated. So the Renaissance we can understand as a period of time where architects were interested to return somehow architectural design, architecture to its origin. But very simple, you know, to re-establish from scratch the language of architecture. The same thing is here, the break between, or the break between Rococo and Schinkel's classicism. So in Schinkel classicism, in Rococo, everything refers to the outside, it's all symbolic. We do not understand anymore why these things are there, but they are there, and they tell a nice story. It's about atmosphere, creating atmospheres, and so on, while Schinkel returns the signs back to their indexicality. Now the signs again talk about an internal condition of architecture as well as an external historical condition. or here, Adolf Loos, it's also interesting, just a few examples, returning back the, some of the facade of a house to its indexicality. It's not at all boring, this building, this house Scheu of Loos, but each window indicates a certain function behind the living room, the bathroom, kitchen, and so on. So all windows are distinguished from each other according what the room or the function is behind. So this is about, you know, returning the sign in architecture to its primordial indexicality and establishing the language out of this. So this is the beginning of a language of modern architecture. Same thing also with Brucius and the Meisterhaus. They're not boring at all, but each element is an indicator of something very specific. They repeat only if the thing behind, or if the connection, the construction or function is alike. So you can make a semiotic analysis of this. This creates a special tension. So you should not look anymore for ornaments and the play of light and shadow, classically, but look for its, you know, its rudimentary semiotics. And then it becomes very interesting. Or the famous corner of Mies van der Rohe at the alumni hall at IIT. So there's much talk about this little piece, vertical piece of steel. Much discussion about it, why this is so, something very special. But what Mies does is nothing else than Vitruv explained in the transition as in the temple, in terms of the transition from wood to stone. Here is a transition to steel. So this little red one, I indicated red, it's a little piece of steel, which is an indicator, it's a placeholder for the column behind, which you cannot see anymore, you cannot expose it, because for reason of fire protection, you have to cover this the steel column. It's a necessity. So, if you build in steel, there's no steel. You cannot see the steel, because the steel has to be covered by a certain material to make it fireproof. In order to show to the outside that the building is made in a steel construction, you have to invent something. You have to invent a new, a modern metal beam or a modern triglyph. So this corner is somehow, it's on the same level as the triglyph in the classical building. It's an indicator, it's an index, where you, it's the only way to perceive that this building is, might have something to do with steel, there might be a steel construction behind it. So people take it as literally, that's no problem, it's okay, so it does its job, but it's not a literal column, the column is behind, and so it becomes also with Tadao Ando and Matsuma House, this is reduced to the max, but it indicates how it is made. Here, in this case, the door does not even have any more a door handle or hinges or things like this. It's only indicated often as a whole that you have a change of the contrast of the bright facade and dark entrance space. So it's really reduced. The indication is then only, it's just somehow the shadow of the play of lighter and brighter and darker pieces. So it's really a reduction. From here, somehow architecture starts again. So all the predecessors, all the followers of Tagao wanted to start to make it more complicated, and then they started to develop a new language of building in concrete or paraconcrete. And this is the last one of the example, that this index can be re-establishment of the index quality. Case of Peter Eisenmann, it's very interesting, the key, contrary to the postmodernist, contrary also to Tadao Ando and others, he was not anymore to interested in re-establishing some of the indexicality of the physical building. But he, what he did, he pushed the discourse of the making and being madeness of architecture, which is normally shown in the building, he pushes it to the design process. So the design process is now about indexicality. The design process tells people or traces somehow how the building is made from the first square to the complex structure. And you see it, of course, also in the real building. But now, somehow, the design process is about indexicality, and not about anymore about production, about meaning, about metaphors, about symbols, about stereotypes or types, but it is about only indexicality. So the indexicality returns on a higher reflexive level in the design process, which is then detached also from its materiality. It's about the indexicality, how the building is perceived, and not anymore how the building is built, like in the case of the Greek temple, Vitruvius, or in the case of Nice. So, and here I think, you know, then we are in a totally different discourse about architectural design. We are back to the indexicality, but not anymore in material terms. Here it's very much detached from its materiality. So in this way, architecture opens itself up to a new kind of thinking, and maybe even to a kind of new kind of transcendence of its materiality, which was always a topic in architecture dealing with indexicality. I think so.